Every single one of you will be confronted with cancer someday, either directly or indirectly. Cancer is the second most common cause of death in the world. And in the Western world, 2 in 3 families are directly affected by it. 1 in 3 men and 1 in 4 women will develop cancer before their age of 75. And the number of cancer cases will even increase in the coming years due to an aging of the population and due to other environmental and living conditions. If the situation does not change, cancer will soon be the leading cause of death. But so far, the bad news. The good news is that today we are detecting and treating cancer in completely new ways, and that's a message that we from the medical research community are more than happy to spread. So let me present this message of hope here for you today. But first, let's go back in time for a minute. People often ask me, is cancer a disease of our times? Is it a modern disease, a disease of the wealthy? Well, no, or at least not completely. Cancer has been documented already in many ancient civilizations. And the cause of cancer has also been speculated a lot about. Until the Middle Ages, it was believed that cancer was a punishment from the gods. And yet there was an important man, Hippocrates, long before the Middle Ages. We know him as the founder of modern-day medicine. He already had a theory, the theory of humores, he called it, where he stated that tumors consist of clotted bodily fluids. Now, we know that's not true, but Hippocrates was the first one to link cancer with natural causes. And then we had to wait a long time to exactly know what cancer is and how to treat it. In the 18th century, there was a very important surgeon, Henri-François Ledran. He stated that cancer was a local disease which could be cured by surgery. But we had to wait until the 19th century, after the invention of the microscopes, 2 German scientists were able to state that tumors consist out of living cells and not clotted bodily fluids or whatever, as previously stated. They even could show that there are differences, microscopic differences, between normal cells and sick cancer cells. And from that day on, cancer was marked as a disease of a cell. Cancer is a disease of the cells of your body. And if you want to understand that properly, you have to know exactly what a cell is. Well, a cell is the smallest living building block of your body. It's not bigger than a hundredth of a millimeter, and yet it contains full of life. It contains little organelles. It contains a nucleus with all genetic material in all chromosomes. And you also have a lot of cells. It is estimated that a human adult body contains about 40 trillion cells. And they all came from one cell, a fertilized ovum. Now, how that came was fairly easy to explain. That one cell, and we call it because the mother cells, can divide itself in exactly 2 the same, we call them the daughter cells. And those daughter cells can divide and again, and you will get 40 trillion cells. And scientists were intrigued by this phenomenon of cell cycle division. They meticulously mapped out what happens during that process of cell division, because you may not forget, it's quite complex, because the mother cells has all genetic material, all organelles, and first she has to make copies of everything to divide it evenly into the 2 daughter cells. And that takes a lot of effort. It takes more than 100 steps to go from 1 cell to 2 cells. Now, probably you think, well, I'm an adult grown body, so there are no cell divisions in my body anymore. Well, then you think wrong, because the cells in your body have only a limited lifespan. For instance, red blood cells, they live about 100 days. You have a lot of red blood cells, so they need to be replaced very frequently. And to give you an idea, at this very moment, in your and my body, every second, about 2.5 million new red blood cells are being formed. Every second, hundreds of thousands new lung cells are being formed. Every second, hundreds of thousands new intestinal cells are being formed. If I were to see you again in about 3 months, you will have completely new intestines. All cells have been replaced by then. Okay, when this complex process takes place million times a second in your and my body, does it always go flawlessly? Well, yes, almost yes, especially when we leave things alone. But if we're going to disrupt this system, then you can have a problem. Say, for instance, that we're in the lungs. Hundreds of thousands of new lung cells are being formed every second. As long as we leave it alone, there is no problem. But let's harm it. Let's disrupt it. I'm going to introduce some harmful substances in the lungs, for instance, from cigarette smoke. And then you have a risk that you're going to disturb the whole cell cycle process. And then you also have the problem that you will end up not with two normal cells, but with one normal cell and a very sick cell. And that can be a cell that cannot divide anymore. That's not such a big deal. You have plenty of other cells that can divide. But in one particular case, it is possible that you end up by a sick cell, which is much more aggressive, divides even faster than the normal cells, and becomes malignant. If that's the case, we call it a cancer cell. So a cancer cell pops up after some mistakes during the process of cell division in the genetic material. Okay, you might say one cancer cell and 40 trillion other cells, cancer cell will lose. No, that's not right, because the cancer cell divides even faster than the normal cells. And at the moment that the normal cells have divided 1, 2, 3 times, the cancer cell has already divided 10, 20, 30 times. Say, for instance, that here at the skin of my hand, one cell, cancer cell pops up. Well, it starts growing and growing and growing. You get a lump of cells here, which we call a growth or a tumor, or when it's malignant, we call it cancer. And those cells are going to proliferate and spread all over the body, and eventually the patient will die. So we have to do something about it. We have to treat this. How are we going to treat it? Well, you all know the three, what we call classical or conventional therapies, being surgery, chemotherapy, and radiotherapy. To frame surgery historically again, well, let's go back to the 18th century again to the French surgeon Henri-François Ledrain, who stated that cancer was a local disease which could be cured by surgery. He was right about that, but he was wrong about the fact that it's only a local disease. In the meantime, we found out that cancer cells can escape from the primary tumor, circulate in your body, form elsewhere secondary tumors, which we call metastases. And what if the surgeon leaves some cancer cells behind? Well, they start growing again, you get new tumors. So especially in a metastatic setting, we need other therapies on top of the surgery. And for that, let's go back in history to World War I. In World War I, people used mustard gas as a chemical weapon. And the soldiers came back into the infirmaries with a lot of problems, a lot of anemia, and they saw that they also had only few red blood cell count. Scientists took this very seriously, investigated it, and they saw that nitrogen mustard derivatives out of the mustard gas were able to block the proliferation of blood cells. And that took the scientists thinking, can't we also use them to block the fastly growing cancer cells? Yes. And the first chemotherapeuticum was born. And until today, we still give chemotherapeutics based on, for instance, nitrogen mustard derivatives. Okay, that's very nice. Let's give it to the cancer patients because we can block the fastly dividing cancer cell. But wait a minute. Didn't we also have normal fastly dividing cells? Yes, we did. Remember the intestines? Within 3 months, other intestines? Well, people that get chemotherapy, they will have some problems with the intestinal system. They get diarrhea, get nausea. The cells of the blood-forming system, 2.5 million new red blood cells each second. So people that get chemotherapy become anemic, become more susceptible to diseases because of a low white blood cell count. The cells of the hair follicles, fastly dividing cells, they lose their hair. So suffice to say that chemotherapy has some very nasty side effects. The third therapy, radiotherapy, cue another historical figure again, Marie Curie. She kind of invented radiation. She had to experience firsthand that irradiation could kill cells, could kill cancer cells, dividing cells. And until now, we use radiotherapy to kill cancer cells. We have now, engineers have provided with fantastic irradiation devices to kill those cancer cells. But again, radiotherapy has some limitations and side effects. With these three therapies, surgery, chemotherapy, and radiotherapy, today we can cure about 60% of the patients. Is it good? Well, you can say yes, but you're going to say no, because 40% you cannot cure. I can treat them, but I cannot cure them. And I want, together with all cancer scientists, that percentage to go up. We want it to go up until at least 80% in the coming 10 years. But how are we going to do that? Not with an improvement of surgery, radiotherapy, and chemotherapy. We have to think out of the box. And we are coming today with completely new therapies. I named some of them, which you probably heard about: gene therapy, targeted therapy, immunotherapy, anti-angiogenic therapy. These are new therapies that enter in the clinic right now. The two most important, targeted therapy and immunotherapy, I will elaborate on that for a minute. To put it bluntly, chemotherapy is a good therapy, but it's kind of a cannonball. And you shoot with a cannonball to the cancer cell, you will hit the cancer cell, but the collateral damage is enormous. I would so much rather use a sniper with a precise aim to shoot out that one cancer cell. And now you can say, yeah, well, of course, why didn't you come with that about 20 years ago? Well, that's because 20 years ago, I didn't know enough of the cancer cell. Yes, I knew it was a fastly dividing cell. So I had to take chemotherapeutics, cytostatics, to block that cell division. But today we know so much more. And I'm going to give you four examples of discoveries in the biomedical field from the last 10 years that have led to these completely new therapies. Two examples from targeted therapy, two examples from immunotherapy. Concerning the target therapy, well, consider a cell again. Cancer cell or normal cell, whatever. We've seen that cells have, on the outside, on the edge, receptors that are kind of docking stations to which molecules from the environment, for instance, growth factor, can attach to. And when that happens, the cell on the inside gets green light to start proliferating. Okay, that's something we knew already for a long time. But now we've seen that cancer cells, smart move from the cancer cells, like breast cancer cells and head and neck cancer cells, they put an enormous extra amount of receptors on the outside. And in that way, they have an enormous growth advantage. The slightest number of growth factors in the neighborhood is enough for the cancer cells to start growing. Again, smart move from the cancer cell, but we cancer researchers have been smarter. We've now developed molecules which kind of resemble the growth factors, but they do not give green light to the cancer cell. And when we put these drugs in the neighborhood of the cancer cell, of course they take up because they think that are growth factors, but it aren't, and the cancer cell blocks all receptors and there was no green light anymore. Those molecules we call antibodies, short AB, and the drugs that we call, the medical drugs that we call, they also end with AB, for instance, cetuximab to treat head and neck cancer. But we've even went some step further. We've also managed to map out what happens from the edge of the cell to the inside of the cell, to the nucleus where the green light has to be given. We've seen that there are different steps that the cell has to take to get from the outside to the inside of the cell. We're talking here about hundreds of millimeters. But we've mapped it out, meticulously mapped it out. And now we've developed very, very small drugs, molecularly targeted drugs, which can penetrate the cancer cell and can block the ways from the edge to the middle of the cell. And in that way, we can inhibit the cancer cell. These molecules are called inhibitors, short for IB, and they all end up with the term IB. For instance, erlotinib to treat lung cancer. And the two other examples are from immunotherapy. It's clear in the meantime that our immune system springs into action against pathogens like bacteria or viruses. Especially in this pandemic world, everybody knows it right now. So a cell of the immune system tries to attack a pathogen. What about cancer? Does a cell of the immune system also attack cancer cells? Oh, yes, it does. It certainly does. Proof for that is seen that we see some immune cells in the neighborhood of all cancer cells. So it's clear that our immune cells try to attack cancer cells. But obviously, they fall short and ultimately they fail. Otherwise, we wouldn't have cancer. Okay, we cancer researchers are going to help the immune system. How are we going to do it? Well, we take out some immune cells out of the patient. We can do it by a simple blood sample. Those immune cells we put in a petri dish in the lab, outside of the body. Then, at the same time, we take some residual cancer cells out of the patient and we put them in the same petri dish. And in that way, we create a kind of a fighting arena. A kind of a battlefield where the immune cells have to fight face to face to the cancer cell. And in that way, the immune cells are going to be trained to fight more efficiently a cancer cell. If you call the immune cells the soldiers of our immune system, we're going to train the soldiers. And afterwards, we put them back out of the petri dish. We take the trained soldiers, the trained immune cells, and we inject them back into the patient. And we see that they are much more efficient in fighting residual cancer cells. We've also seen how the immune system works, and we've seen that immune cells have kind of an on-off switch. That's something new. That on-off switch, we call it immune checkpoints, is mostly on the off position, let's say in the non-attack mode. And that's very important because cells of the immune system, they don't always have to fight, because otherwise you have the risk that they will fight normal, harmless cells. They have an off position. But when it comes in the neighborhood of a pathogen, like for instance a bacteria, it puts the switch to the on position, to the attack mode, and it attacks the bacteria and the bacteria will disappear. Okay, what happens to a cancer cell? Is that the same? Well, we've now seen that when an immune cell comes into the neighborhood of a cancer cell, if we are lucky, it will recognize the cancer cell. We're not always that lucky, but that's another story. But if we are lucky, it recognizes the cancer cell, it puts the switch on the on position, attack mode, and we know what we saw then? We saw that some cancer cells are able to switch off that switch again, put it back in the non-attack mode, and the immune cell turns down, goes away, and the tumor can grow. But now we've developed some molecules, we call it the immune checkpoint inhibitors, that can put on the switch back on, more powerful than the cancer cell that's trying to put it off. And those are molecules that come into the clinic right now with an enormous success, for instance, for skin cancer. But we are doing some investigations for all kinds of other treatments. This is a very important immunotherapy, in fact. I've only given you a few examples now of what we cancer researchers are doing. And of course, not just me, my entire research group, all cancer researchers all over the world united as one. One thing's for sure, our efforts will lead to completely new detection and treatment systems. And it's my belief that one day we will defeat the cancer cell. And the more research we do, the sooner that day will come. It's cancer's turn to be afraid now.